Good day, good folks. You are listening to Talk That Keeps You Woke. And with your awakening, we hope that you will take in the information and knowledge we provide. So make sure you like and subscribe while you hop on this ride as we inform, persuade, entertain, and engage in discussion. Welcome to Pot Liquor Podcast, which is knowledge to feed your soul. I make up one half of Pot Liquor. I go by Dr. A, the inquisitive one. A great debater, Mr. Slow Talker, a rhetorician, and an all-around nice guy, and a member of Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity Incorporated. The other half of Pot Liquor is my homie, my dear friend for more than 30 years, Kim Parker Jackson Esquire, the legal one, Mrs. Creativity, never obnoxious, the gifted one, a terrific lady, and a member of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority Incorporated. Okay, welcome back. What's up, partner? How you been?
Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening to everyone. I am well. And as you know, Dr. A, life be lifing, but we're going to push through because that's what we do. And how are you?
Okay, well, summer session started. Well, the second summer session started at Texas Southern University. And I'm on board there. We just finished week one of 5 weeks. So I'm back into the flow of things. I can say that. So welcome to Pot Liquor Podcast. And as always, as you're familiar with our show, we start off with our wow for the week. And this week is coming from Justice, the Honorable Justice Ketanji Brown Jackson. And this was in her dissent, which we're going to jump into. But deeming race irrelevant in law does not make it so in life. And basically, she's just trying to tell us that just because we have this written down on paper, that doesn't mean that people obey and follow it. That doesn't mean that marginalized groups or African-American, Hispanics, Asians, you know, people of color don't face discrimination and have been for a long time. And so we'll get into the affirmative action. But again, but deeming race irrelevant in law does not make it so in life. What say you, partner?
Basically, I just would sum this up by saying that actions speak louder than words, and you can say that we live in a colorblind society all day long, but we see every day that race in America is indeed a factor.
Okay, well said. I didn't think it was going to come to a stop like that. But yes, I do agree point with blank you on that.
In the period.
So before we get into our first what's going on, we always will give you our first plug of the day. And our first plug of the day, and this is me. This is Advil, and this is the liquid gel. And the reason why I'm putting this up today, I know probably many of you have it, it's been helping me lately. You know, I'm suffering from a lot of aches and pains that just comes with age. Just little annoyances. I don't take it on a regular basis, but I like the gel because it operates, you know, quickly. It has an impact and an effect quickly. So that's why I like that.
And let us move on.
Okay, so what's going on? We are going to talk about affirmative action because it is impacting a lot of us around the country, especially students trying to get into higher ed. So we'll first start with affirmative action.
Okay.
The decision came down that race is no longer allowed to be used as a factor of getting into colleges. Now, mind you, this was passed down from for the University of Harvard and University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, that they could not use it in as a part of the admissions process. And I will read a little bit of the decision. Harvard College and the University of North Carolina are two of the oldest institutions of higher learning in the United States. Every year, tens of thousands of students apply to each school. Many fewer are admitted. Both Harvard and UNC employ a highly selective admissions process to make their decisions. Admission to each school can depend on a student's grades, recommendation letters, or extracurricular involvement. It can also depend on their race. The question presented is whether the admission systems used by Harvard College and UNC are lawful under the Equal Protection Clause for the 14th Amendment. At Harvard, each application for admission is initially screened by a first reader who assigns a numerical score in each six categories: academic, extracurricular, athletic, school support, personal, and overall. For the overall category, a composite of the five other ratings, a first reader can and does consider the applicant's race. Harvard's admission subcommittee then reviews all applicants from a particular geographic area. These regional subcommittees make recommendations to the full admissions committee, and they take the applicant's race into account. When the 40-member full admissions committee begins its deliberations, it discusses the relative breakdown of applicants by race. The goal of the process, according to Harvard's director of admissions, is ensuring there is no dramatic drop-off in minority admissions from the prior class. So that is what they ruled against. What say you, partner?
Well, I don't think that anybody is surprised by this decision, especially since Roe v. Wade was overturned. After 50 years of precedent. So we're not surprised that this court, which is majority conservative, six conservative justices to three liberal justices, nobody's surprised that affirmative action was overturned. However, and I have an official statement that I would like to make, because when this decision came down on June 29th of this year, everybody was making their, you know, comments about it and opining about it. And so I said, well, let me have my own official statement. So I would like to say that it was a sad day in America on Thursday, June 29th, 2023, when the Supreme Court turned back the hands of time and dismantled the guardrails that affirmative action had erected to ensure that Black people could be afforded educational opportunities that we had previously been denied as a result of simply being Black. So the way I look at it is affirmative action is basically a policy aimed at increasing workplace and educational opportunities for people who are underrepresented in various areas of our society. And again, we just have to think about it as it was created out of necessity. That's what I say. It wasn't created in a vacuum. And I think we need to just reflect on why this policy was created in the first place. Because a lot of times in America, seeing is believing and understanding. For example, we all knew that Black people were being disproportionately killed by the police, you know, being unarmed. We all knew that. But when America saw on video George Floyd actually being murdered before our eyes, then people seemed to, you know, wake up and understand that this is a reality. This is what we have been trying to tell you this whole time. Right. And so for me, as an example of why we needed affirmative action, I did some research. There's a man, his name is Marion Hood. You can Google him and see for yourself, but he was denied admission to Emory University Medical School. This was, and he literally, this was back in August the 5th of 1959. And his rejection letter, he shared it with the public, his rejection letter from the director of admissions at Emory University's medical school, and I quote, said, "I am sorry, I must write to you that we are not authorized to consider for admission a member of the Negro race. I regret that we cannot help you. I am returning here with your $5 application fee." So he was clearly told, because you're Black, you cannot be admitted to this school. Not because your test scores are low, not because your grades are low, not because you're not qualified, but because you're Black. And so this, to me, in order to remedy that kind of wrong that was done against African Americans, you have to do the, you have to reverse engineer it. And so you have to say affirmatively, Black people are going to be allowed admission into particular schools. And that's really the only way to fix what you broke, because that, I mean, just think about what opportunities he lost by not being able to go to that particular.
Let me just interject real quick, because of that last statement you said. It really means that Black people, a minority people, will receive points, and that will heavily be put into consideration because of their race. It's just leveling the playing field.
Yeah, that's all. Yeah. That's all. That and so, you know, but I just, my overall thought about what happened is, in the immortal words of Kendrick Lamar, we gonna be all right, because that's what we do. That's what we've done. We're still here. And I think that Black existence is resistance. So we're gonna keep living. We're gonna keep, we're not going anywhere. And we're just going to make it work like we've always done. So all is not lost. This is what is to be expected when you have this kind of court that's majority conservative. And to all of the people who say there's no difference between the Republican Party and the Democratic Party, here is your proof that there is indeed a difference. Because if we had had Hillary Clinton instead of Trump, we would still have abortion rights. We would still have affirmative action. You guys would still have all of your student loans paid off. And so it matters. What do you think, Dr. Ed?
Well, yeah. The sad thing about it, too, is they're starting to visit this in corporate America, too. So now, if you're an African American and you apply for anything and you receive it, it's going to be, they're trying to take it away. Well, it's not because you're Black, because they did away with affirmative action. They're still going to think that, because they're always going to think, if that's their mindset, they're always going to think you're less qualified, even when you're more qualified.
Exactly.
So
I say
it's a shameful day, you know, a time that we are revisiting this and revoking it. What the young kids put on their text all the time, SMH, shaking my head.
Yeah.
That's just my reaction to it. Not utterly shocked by it at all.
Right. You know?
But it's just like, well, they put it back in place. They did what they set out to do.
Right.
And it's a sad day.
Right. It's just unfortunate because it just seems like they created this division of the races to maintain power and literally subjugated Black people to the bottom rung of societies through exploitation, free labor, slavery, all of that. And now when we can actually use race to receive a benefit, when Black people can use race to receive a benefit, now race is a problem. Isn't that something? That's what gets me. It's a problem now. But you literally structured this society based on race so that you can maintain power, this white power structure.
Yeah.
But again, when there's something that can benefit Black people, wait a minute. This is a colorblind society. We cannot consider race. So it's just, you know, hypocritical. It's wrong, flat out wrong. And
I mean, when it comes to collegiate sports on campuses, especially in the big three sports, that's college football, college basketball, and college girls basketball, you don't see those problems. There's no issue of race there because they feel like,
isn't that something?
They don't question our athletic prowess.
Okay.
Especially our athletic prowess is going to help them bring a ton of money into the institution. But they question our intellectual efficacy. So I don't know. That's something to look at.
But you know, the other thing is they said in the opinion that race could be a factor in terms of military, in terms of the military. So yeah, we don't look at race when we want you to volunteer to risk your life for the country, but to receive an educational benefit, no, we cannot consider race. But
and let us move on.
All right, so we're going to start off with Judge Clarence Thomas' opinion. What say you about his opinion?
Well, I kind of skimmed through his opinion, and I think the one thing that stood out to me is when he said two discriminatory wrongs cannot make a right. Permitting universities to discriminate based on race in their admissions process in order to achieve alleged educational benefits of diversity, in his mind, is wrong. So Justice Thomas doesn't think diversity is a compelling state interest. It's not. He just doesn't think that diversity is a legitimate goal to achieve through affirmative action. That just, to me, is just flat out wrong. Because, I mean, how boring would it be if everybody in a learning environment has the same perspective? You know?
Okay. I'm gonna jump in real quick. Mm-hmm. And this might seem like I'm defending Clarence Thomas, but I'm not. I'm just giving it context. He takes this personal because what happened to him personally. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. He went to Holy Cross undergrad and he got into Yale Law School. And his classmates thought he was there because he was Black, because of affirmative action. And that teed him off because he felt like all the white folks that were talking to him, telling him he's an excellent student, you know, he scored well at Holy Cross, but then saying that he thought was like, wow, they've been telling me this the whole time, but they put me here at Yale Law School because I was Black. It was the first year Yale was having an affirmative action program. And he wanted everybody to know, like, I got here on my own merit. So I think he feels that having diversity, or well, not having diversity, I take that back. Affirmative action is a negative stigma for people of color, because people are thinking like, you're not here on right. your merit. You know, you're here because of your race. And then afterwards, when he went to try to get a job, everyone said, because of your Yale degree, you know, law degree, you know, and you're Black, you're going to get a job. And that wasn't the case for him. He didn't get a job in corporate America. And he was married. He had a child by then. And so, again, he thought, like, this is tomfoolery, this whole affirmative action. So personally, this is the reason why he gets it. He feels like African Americans can get into these institutions on their own merit, don't need a boost or a pick me up to help them out. He thinks of it as a stigma. He doesn't look at the numbers and say, it's not a stigma. It's definitely racial. You know, when you attend the institution, that's a high institution and it's predominantly white. There are a few things that you can consider. Maybe some, especially today, some students, minority, don't want to attend that institution. It could be the location where that institution is in some parts of America. And I people might laugh at it. You know, everybody's not want to go to school in Wyoming, Montana, Vermont, New Hampshire. And if you're thinking like, well, Dr. A, you're naming a lot of predominantly white states. I am. You know, culture is very important to a lot of people. And until you're absent of it, you won't understand it. But there are some students that a minority that they don't care. They don't have to be surrounded by their culture. They feel like they can survive without that. I'm just speaking for myself when I say that. So I'm just saying that this is the reason why that Thomas, you know, I should say Judge Thomas.
Justice Thomas,
I'm sorry. Has these views.
But I understand that, but I don't think it's fair for him to project his own insecurities onto the whole race. Just because you're Black doesn't mean that you get to project your insecurity onto the whole race. Like, for me personally, I don't care how I got into the school. Once I get in, I bet you I'll get out.
Well, explain this. What do you mean by his insecurity? He's basically saying, I'm good enough. I don't need your assistance.
Okay, let me explain.
Hold on, let me finish the question. He's saying, when I get your assistance, you label and you stigmatize me.
You're insecure because you're concerned about what somebody thinks about you. I don't care. Give me all of the benefits that I can get. I was going to say entitled to, but when you say entitled, people just get up in arms like you want a handout. But Black people are owed a lot in this country. And I'm like Warren G. I want it all. Brand new socks and drawers. I want it all. So I don't care what you call it. If it's available as a benefit to me and to Black people in this country, then we should get it. I don't care what you think about it, because see, we don't look down on white people when they receive benefits, when they've gotten all kinds of military benefits, all kinds of housing benefits, all kinds of PPP loans, and all kinds of, we don't look down on them when they, when they're multi-million dollar companies getting PPP loans and not having to pay it back.
Okay, so let me,
we don't call them, you know.
So let me say this. There are a lot, I know a lot of students, Black students, even Black students that went to my institution and I went to HBCU, that think that way. That think the way Clarence Thomas thinks, because they feel like they are superior. I don't know, you might call it insecure, okay? They might call it, you know, it irritates them and they're frustrated by it. So with you, your statement is, and then it's how you come up. Say you come up with a lot of white friends. You go to school with them. You communicate with them. You are social with them. And then they feel like you go to school and these other students are looking at you like you don't deserve to be here.
Okay.
They have a feeling, even though you feel a different way, there's some people that feel it's, they don't like that.
They don't like,
they don't like that people, you know, passing judgment on them that they got here because of their race. Because it's been said to them.
Okay. Cause I mean, I went to Georgetown University and nobody ever said that to me. Like, you're here. They may have thought it, but nobody said, oh, you're just here because you're Black.
Okay.
But nobody said that to me. But if they had, I would have kept walking like, and
okay, but what I'm trying to say to you, exactly, that's you. So let's think of the people.
But that's a lot of other people too. And all I'm saying is it's not fair for, it's to me, it's like somebody telling you that they know what's best for you. Because nobody ever asked Black people, what do you need? They always want to say, well, this is, they don't need.
That's not true. That's too general when you say that.
Okay. All right. Well.
But I'm saying, I get what you're saying. What I'm trying to get you to do.
Benefits without asking us.
I'm trying to get you.
Oh, did you need that? Did you need early childhood education for your kids? Did you need a subsidy for child care? Did you need Medicare, Medicaid? Did you need SNAP benefits? We didn't know that. I'm just saying this.
The only reason why I'm telling you,
that's all I'm saying.
Only reason why I'm telling you, because I don't want you to go down the lane of the rabbit hole that white folks have not tried to do anything to help Black folks in this country. And that's just
I'm not saying that at all. I'm not saying that at all. I'm talking about government. I'm not saying white folks. I'm saying just government.
I'm talking about government too. Just because decisions are made, that doesn't mean everybody in government is for one side. But what I'm trying to get you to think is, like, I know you say, and you do this, you say, I wouldn't care. But I'm asking you to address the people who do care that are Black. So, and I'm saying, let me finish. Do they have a point?
Okay, I will say you have a point. People may think that because affirmative action exists, that because you are here at a PWI, you must be here because of affirmative action, even if you're not. Even if you were the valedictorian of your class and you got 1600 on your SATs and you do community service and you have a star athlete, they're still going to think that you were there because of affirmative action. And then now that affirmative action has been overturned, they're still going to think that you are inferior. So what difference does it make? That's what I'm saying.
Well, that's a good
point. People are going to think what they want to think.
That's, so, that's, But that's a good point.
Right. So we might as well get the benefits to which we are entitled. That's all I'm saying. Because it's not going, people are going to think that you are inferior either way. That's all I'm saying. So I don't care what you think. I really don't. Because listen, you know how they say, what do you call a doctor?
See, that's not compassion.
No, what do you call? No, they say, what do you call a medical student who graduates at the bottom of their class?
Doctor.
So it doesn't, it's like, I don't care which, at the end of the day, I'm going to graduate from this school and I'm going to have a degree from this school. I don't care how I got in. And you shouldn't care how I got in because I'm going to get out and I'm going to kill it. So
when you say, I don't care what you think, you're talking about those who think you're in here because of your race. You're talking about those people. Right. You don't care what they're. Okay.
I don't care what they think. And so that's all I'm saying. I understand, Justice Thomas, that this was your experience and you felt this stigma and you don't want other Black people to feel the way that you do. But I think that you are making an assumption that that is how most of us or many of us feel. And that's not necessarily so. That's all I'm saying, Justice Thomas. Don't take away our benefits. Give us more. We're owed for free labor for many years for making this country an economic powerhouse. Or as Dr. Greg Carr calls it, this criminal enterprise.
I would just say to Justice Thomas is you think affirmative action is not needed. And I would say to you, you're wrong. Because even though a lot of us are deserving, that doesn't mean that we get in.
Exactly.
You feel like there's still not hatred because folks have black skin, right? You feel like that doesn't exist. And I would tell you, it does.
Yes, it does.
Let us move on.
All right. So from one opinion from a black Supreme Court justice to another opinion of a black Supreme Court justice.
Indeed. Justice Ketanji Brown Jackson, she was nominated by President Biden because he promised to nominate a black woman to the Supreme Court, and he kept his promise. Well, I would say what the first sentence of her dissent sums up the whole thing for me. She said, "Gulf-sized race-based gaps exist with respect to the health, wealth, and well-being of American citizens." She said they, referring to the wealth gaps, were created in the distant past, but have indisputably been passed down to the present day through the generations. Every moment these gaps persist is a moment in which this great country falls short of actualizing one of its foundational principles, the self-evident truth that all of us are created equal. That sums it up for me. And she's
right. I'm definitely on her side when it comes to this decision. And you can say I'm biased because of my entire life. I'll plead guilty to that. But to me, she's the only one that's making true sense out of this and looking at it from a realistic life perspective. The folks that are against affirmative action feel that African-Americans are coming in, taking spots that rightfully belong to their kids and things of that nature. And I would say that couldn't be farther from the truth. You know, it's not only how well you do with your grades, because that makes for a dull and insipid institution. I teach and I teach communications. And sometimes people who are super smart say little or say nothing. Mm-hmm. I don't want all those folks in my class. When I'm in my course, in my class, it's about topic discussion. It's about opening up. And I'm not painting every bright, high-achieving academic student that is white boring or non-communicative. And that doesn't just go for white students. That goes for high-achieving students, right. People of color. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they don't say enough because maybe all they did was dive in to their academics when they were in school, high school.
But class participation is a part of your grade, right?
Not really.
No? Okay.
No, because the reason why you can't do that, because there are some people that have issues.
Oh, they can't speak publicly?
Well, they feel nervous and flustered and they have anxiety. They have, you know, mental health issues, which is a real thing.
Okay. So you're saying you personally don't consider class participation as part of the student's grade, or you're saying
no,
in general?
I would, but I don't think it's fair to do that when you do have people that are afraid of, especially people in this generation who usually communicate by social media, or that communicates a lot by social media. When you get in front of 24 or 34 other people to speak and to verbally spar with your classmates, you might get flustered and nervous, or, you know, you might not do well at that. So, okay. You know, I make sure I ask them a question or two, but what I'm saying is that's why I'd rather have a B student in my class that's loquacious than an A student that's silent.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't teach math. I teach communication. So in communications, you need to talk. So there's a difference.
Well, that's why I was surprised that you don't consider class participation as part of the student's grade in your communications class.
Well, you have to participate in the speaking assignments. Like if there's a speech, yes, but I'm talking about
just classroom discussion.
Classroom discussion, yes. Okay. You have some people that's just, they're not going to do it.
Right.
You know,
you know, it's ironically, Clarence Thomas was notoriously quiet during oral arguments. Like he never asked questions. He just kind of listened to his associate justices ask all the questions and listen to the answers from counsel, but he was notoriously quiet. And I think people have said it was because he was self-conscious about his cadence being from Georgia.
Mm.
Have you heard that?
I have, but he's spoken enough now.
Well, yeah, I think he's getting over it. I don't know if he had therapy or whatever, but
since 90, because I think he was confirmed either in 91 or 92 is when that whole Anita Hill thing happened.
Mm-hmm. Because he was nominated by Bush, George. Yeah. Was it H.W.? I always get them confused. But the father or the son.
Herbert Walker, yeah.
Okay, so that's the son, right? Yeah.
No.
Is that the father or the son? I always get confused, but
he was y'all voted can in by the father. Bush, the son, was 2000 to 2008, and then Barack was 2008 to 2016.
Okay, there you go.
So it was the dad. So yeah,
but you said something. You said something about white students thinking that black students have taken their place in these classes when they get admitted to schools.
Yeah, and parents of white students.
Right. So they think because this black person was admitted, wasn't admitted, they took his or her space.
Yeah.
But I don't necessarily think that overturning affirmative action is going to help that white student any more than it does now, because let's just look at the numbers.
That's why I said it's far from the truth.
Right. If you look at the numbers in 2022 at Harvard, 4.59% of the students that applied to the school were accepted. So they have a less than 5% acceptance rate at Harvard. It's like playing the lottery. You could be the best student in the country, but the numbers are not going to help you. It's just like all of the qualified people who could get in have to basically play the lottery to get accepted to Harvard. That's what it's like.
But so, hold that thought.
Let me give you the numbers.
No. Go ahead. That's a perfect point. What white students are saying, that's for us. They say
4.59% is for
us. Right, it's for us. They're saying if I'm black, my chances with my scores increase. That's what they're saying. They're like increasing. And I would say to them, it should. Because if you go look at the percentage of the population at that institution, you'll see it's overwhelmingly white. Right. I think it's getting more diversified, but it's overwhelmingly white.
Okay, so as I was saying, with the numbers for this 1 year, 2022 admissions at Harvard, out of 42,749 applicants, 1,962 were accepted. And guess how many were black? 196, approximately 10%. So you want me to believe that it's only 196 black students were accepted, and you want to fight over them 196 students and say one of the 196 should have been me. When you were at one of 49,000 people, are you serious right now? You see how that just the math ain't mathing for me. So
yeah, but they're thinking, you're right. They're thinking out of those 196, say they're saying at least 100 of those
should have been
exactly. And it increases my chances, not by much, but it still increases my chances. I agree with you. I always try to make sense of what they're thinking.
But again, we haven't even talked about legacy admissions.
Right. Well, they're addressing that now.
Right.
They're starting to address that now.
Yeah. So.
Right. Because white folks that don't have mothers and fathers and grandparents that attended the institutions, they're saying, wait a minute, y'all getting in too. And y'all ain't definitely brighter than me or a better applicant than me. You're getting in because your parents are alumni and they donate money to the institution, and it's a game. But that's life. I would tell these students, welcome to life, welcome to capitalism. That's how this country is run.
Because listen, a lot of black people got into predominantly white institutions because of affirmative action. Let's assume that that's true. Now that we can also benefit, these black people can also benefit from legacy admissions. In other words, now our children can maybe get a boost and go to some of these same schools. It's ironic because, for example, my husband went to UVA. I went to Georgetown. Say if our students got accepted to UVA and Georgetown. Now we have to pay that tuition. So that's, to me, a disincentive. Unless they're going to get a full scholarship, which they probably won't, because of now that we've gone to these institutions, we've been able to raise our socioeconomic status to a certain level. And so therefore, you're not going to get the same financial aid or assistance that our parents got, because our parents didn't have much. So we were able to get the funding to go, and coming from these elite institutions, you are able to raise your own socioeconomic status, and now your children can go. And if they get a boost and get legacy admissions, especially now that affirmative action has been overturned, we can't pay. I know.
Speak for yourself, because there's a lot of people that graduated from y'all two institutions that are making that type of money.
Also, where they can just cut that check.
Those institutions, I don't know, we can look it up. I'm sure the University of Virginia and Georgetown University, Georgetown not as much, have stronger populations. Harvard is not a big institution. That's one. You just said they admit only 1,000 and something out of 40.
That was for the freshman class.
Yeah. Right. But that's what I'm saying, every year. So if it's 1,000 and something, so say it's 2,000 and it's 4, that's like 8,000 students at the school in just undergrad. So that's not a huge institution. But schools like Syracuse, University of Maryland, Texas A&M University, they're trying to get minorities, quote unquote, to come to their school. Even though we'll be talking about my institution soon, because they have so many students that come to the institution in the first place.
Yeah. I think the good news, though, is that it's still legal for schools to collect the data on the demographics of race. So you can be asked to disclose your race during the admissions process. They just can't use it as a factor in their admissions decision. So that way, I think that's important, because we'll still be able to recognize those patterns and patterns of whether or not fewer Black people are now being admitted after this policy has been passed or not. Or, you know, so we can see the patterns of discrimination that may be occurring, and schools can still figure out how to achieve those diversity goals without, you know, affirmatively stating, no pun intended, affirmatively stating that they are using race as a factor in admissions. You see what I'm saying? So, I mean, schools will still be able to figure out how, and I think Harvard even released a statement saying that that is exactly what they intend to do. They intend to achieve their diversity goals another way. So all is not lost. People who want to do what's right can still figure out how to do that. And people who want to be racist and discriminate can now do it under cover of law. That's all this means to me. Now the law is on your side. You can do it. And I can't say, well, they didn't let me in because I'm Black. I can't go legally challenge that now because of what the Supreme Court has held.
All right.
And let us move on.
Don't stop now. Okay, so we're going to get into our second plug, which is our brand. And it is Adidas.
Oh, those are nice. Oh.
All right. So these are two pair of Adidas I rarely wear. I'm about to give them away.
I was about to say, they look good. Why don't you wear them?
I don't know. I can't tell you why. Sometimes I put them on, just the difference. But
like to match your outfits and stuff?
I'm probably... Sometimes, but I got other colors to match. I'm all about comfort. These are comfortable. Mm-hmm. They are. If you can see, like, the cushion in the heels of them, they're very a comfortable sneaker. But
they
yes,
like they would be good for training.
They're more cross training, yeah. But okay. you know you can style them too. When you get older, you tend to wear running shoes.
Right, tell me about it.
Yeah, because they have the cushion and the soft,
exactly. You know,
and that's what you're gonna need. You know,
okay. help
them bones out. Yeah,
your knees.
Exactly. So Adidas is the product.
Well, all right.
We have a question. It's a question. Address the question. This is a question. So what's the question? Answer the question. Hey. Okay, question of the week. What breaks and never falls, and what falls and never breaks? That is our question of the week. What breaks and never falls, and what falls and never breaks?
And let us move on.
What was last week's question?
I'll get to it.
Black.
Hey.
Black, black, black. Black on black, black. Yeah. Hey. Okay, black, 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 black on black, black, my thoughts so black, black, black on black, my skin is so black, I'm rocking that black on black is black. Rims on this black.
Okay, we have faces, body, and soul.
I love
it. It is a jewelry and accessory business that's started by somebody very familiar to me. And instead of us speaking for it, we're going to bring on the owner and operator and creator of these products.
Hello. Hello. Hello.
New York. So let's kind of get her bigger. We'll put the logo back up again. There she is.
Hello, everyone.
Hi, Dr. Hello. York.
Hello, Pot Liquor Podcast, Dr. A, Kim Parker Jackson. How are y'all doing?
Good, good, good. Welcome back.
Tell us a little bit about Faces, Body, and Soul Jewelry and Accessories.
Okay, this is something that has been like a passion of mine ever since my story is, I grew up, I had keloid skin. And so ever since, so after like around 9 years old, my mother, I had surgery to remove the keloid. So I couldn't wear pierced earrings. So I was always have to wear clip-on earrings. So when I saw fashionable earrings, I would say, man, how could I, you know, also wear those? So I started converting earrings. Then I started making them. And when I would make them, people would say like, wow, like, where did you get those from? And I said that I made them. So during Juneteenth, I made some that were kind of African inspired, and you can see those behind me. So people just started asking about it. And I said, you know what? Let me just do this. It's something that I've always wanted to do. And I want to inspire women. I'm all about health and really health and also beauty for women of color. So, and that's where the name came from. You know, like people see our faces. Yes, you know, on the outside, we can be beautiful. We may have something going on in the inside, but on the outside, you know, we can project and maybe we'll feel that on the inside.
Indeed, indeed. And I love accessories myself. So can you tell us, are these just for women who need to wear clip-ons, or can women that have the holes in their ears also wear them?
Yes, these are for women with clip-on and pierced. So I have some that I can convert, some are not convertible. So, you know, and I'll try to, so usually when I post the earrings, I have my Instagram, Faces, Body, Soul, Jewelry, and I put on there, you know, ones that can be converted, because sometimes you can't convert them to clip-ons.
Okay.
So they're for pierced and clip-on.
Okay. So can you show us a couple of your favorite pairs and tell us how much they cost? What's the price point? Sure. And what else do you have?
Sure. So these are my initial creations.
Beautiful.
And what I do is I try to use sustainable products other than the hardware on there. Mm-hmm. I use material, you know, I have the leather look. I also have this is my college line. So I make, you know, whatever your college is, I'll go and find some material with that college logo on there. And I try to add, you know, try to adorn it. This is a University of Houston inspired line. But I try to use like material. So the leather, the polyurethane, you know, like any type of other material, but these are my favorite. These are something that can be worn You know, if you're going to a gala, you know, like a special event. And right now I'm running the She's a 10 special. So I feel like, you know, I want to, you know, we're a 10. Unfortunately, society has labeled this. We can be a 20, but according to society, a 10 is the highest. So I'm running a $10 special unless they're custom made. So if you want them custom made, it's going to be 15 because I'm going to have to go out and get the material and find it. So, you know, and these are some also that I made. And then here's just a little close up of them too, how I put the material on there. And I try to make sure that it's not fraying. But if you have a belt, if you have an outfit that you're wearing and you have a belt, I can, you can bring me the material for the belt and I'll make it custom made. I've done that for my own attire, you know, and you can have some matching earrings.
Okay, so where do we go to purchase these beautiful items?
So you can go to Faces Body Soul. I have an Instagram. Let me make sure I have that because I'm only like in my third week. So Faces Body Soul Jewelry is my IG. And if you go there, you can send me a message and I'll, and you can Cash App. And I have my Cash App on there also. It's $FEE York. And the delivery is going to vary because, you know, if you order several pair and then depending on your location. So I'll discuss that with you also.
Okay.
But I'm very flexible, you know, like this is something that I love. Here is a someone liked, I had on some red ones. So this young lady liked the red ones that I had on. So she wanted me to custom make. She has a lemon yellow dress that she's wearing. So I've packaged these up for her.
Beautiful.
She's gonna meet me. She's in Houston, so, and she's going to meet me. So, of course, there's no charge for that. But delivery, it'll depend on the number that you buy, you know, et cetera.
Okay. I like the concentric circles.
Yes, yes. And I try to add a little touch to everything because I want you to feel like, you know, special. It's something you can't get anywhere else. So I just added these little circles here, and I have some like some rubber materials that I'm thinking about making. So this is something that I love. Like I'll stay up all night. Like
and I see which the ones you're wearing, are those shaped in a triangle?
They are. They are.
Well, I really love those.
Inspiration to my sorority, Delta Sigma Thetas, get to Kim Parker Jackson and I sorority.
Yeah.
And if you go to my Instagram, I also have colors that are inspired by the Divine Nine ladies, sororities. Nice. So if you look on there, it's like the color scheme. So, and I'm also looking for things, you know, that I can buy for specifically with the, those Greek symbols. So.
Right.
Now is the Cash App.
$FEE York.
Okay. Oh, okay. York. Thank you.
But when I'll see that when I go to your Instagram.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
All right.
Yes.
All right.
Well, we wish you all the success in the world. Cha-ching, cha-ching.
Cha-ching, cha-ching.
Let the dollars roll in. Yes.
Thank
you. All right. Thank you again.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Black. Black on black, black. Yeah. Hey. Okay, black, black on black, my thoughts so black on black, my skin is so black, I'm rocking that black on black is black.
Black rims on this black wheel.
And let us move on.
Blackness, keep on.
Yeah, so today we want to highlight for our little known Black history fact, General Michael E. Langley. General Michael Langley was the first African-American four-star general in the U.S. Marine Corps. He was promoted to the rank of general on August 6, 2022 in a ceremony at Marine Corps Barracks in Washington. Langley was born in Shreveport, Louisiana, and grew up on a variety of military bases as a child before settling in Texas. He graduated from the University of Texas at Arlington and commissioned as a second lieutenant in 1985. Langley has served in the Marine Corps for 37 years and saw his promotion as a sign to others that Marine Corps service rewards those who work hard to achieve their goals. General Michael E. Langley, our little known Black History Fact. And see, this is why we need affirmative action, because although this is a great honor, it's 2022 and we're still having first African American people to do things.
You are right. I like it. So this is our third plug of the day, which is always our podcast. And this one is Her Space, which H-E-R stands for Healing, Empowerment, and Resilience. Her Space. And in a world where Black women are often underrepresented and misunderstood, we need more safe spaces to just be. Every Friday, join Dr. Dominique Brassard, a college professor and a psychologist, and Terry Lomax, a techie and motivational speaker, as they initiate authentic conversation on everything from fibroids to fake friends. If you're a Black woman or a woman of color looking for an extra dose of inspiration on the go, pull up a seat and join us on the Cultivating Her Healing, Empowerment, Resilience Space podcast. Episodes are published every Friday on iTunes and most platforms where podcasts are played. Learn more about your favorite host here. So that is... Ooh, I'm sorry. That is Her Space.
Well, all right. All right.
And let us move on.
Oh, hell no.
So this week,
oh, hell no.
We're going to hear from Craig Kelly, who had a rant about Juneteenth. I'm hoping that y'all can hear this.
Is another opportunity to get wasted. And that's what people are doing. All right. We drink on the Super Bowl, we drink on Christmas, and people are drinking on this Juneteenth. And yeah, all across the country, pub crawls. Yeah, Juneteenth bar crawl. Let's drink up to honor what happened in Texas all those years ago. You know, again, this country, we have major addiction problems all over the place, yet another opportunity to drink or get high? No, because if you put this stuff together, especially in urban areas where the Juneteenth celebrations have been the most intense, you got alcohol plus guns plus time on your hands plus weed plus hate and the overall resentment of the system, what's that going to result in? Any guesses?
So I don't know, did you hear that?
Not as well as I would like to, but I did hear it.
All right. So it picked up on my mic, hopefully. Basically, what happened, this is a gentleman who is known as a racist or plays a racist on radio, and he was going off on Juneteenth like it's just another day to celebrate and drink and the violence, then weed. He just brought in a whole lot of stuff really to stir up this conversation. That's why we say,
oh, hell no,
to him, because he ain't about sugar. And so this is something that we should celebrate. The United States should celebrate. And it's a day, I don't know who doesn't mind the day off, you know?
Right. I mean, I think he's confusing this with Cinco de Mayo. Isn't that where they do the pub crawls and the
Halloween? The Hispanic will tell you the Cinco de Mayo is racist too, the way they push it out there, because that's all they are doing is celebrating drinking. And we'll get back into a Cinco de Mayo soon, but we're gonna stay here with Juneteenth. Juneteenth is just a celebration of freedom, you know, and that's what it should be, you know, recognizing that. You know, the one state was still in slavery 2 years later and they got out. So, again, a big,
oh, hell no.
I think it's this, you know, obviously is very ignorant. He's very ignorant for saying this. However, I think that, you know, it's sad that people with the same sentiment exist today. And I think it's important for us to hear these things so that we are reminded of this every now and then, that this sentiment indeed exists among us, and we have to remain vigilant and not be lulled into a false sense of comfort. Like, we have to stay alert and remain vigilant.
And let us move on.
So this week, we're going to give it up to Tracy Chapman. This is a while ago, but she had a number one country song, or has a number one country song in the nation. And it's a remake of her classic song, Fast Car.
From 1988.
Right, right, right.
The year I graduated from college.
Yeah,
I remember that was a big record for her. So this is
That was a huge record. Yes, definitely. It is crossover and everything.
And she became the first ever, here we go, 2023. See what I'm saying? First ever Black woman to have the only songwriting credit on a number one country hit.
Well, I ain't going to chalk that up to race. I'm just going to chalk that up to culture.
Well, I mean,
it's not like we were prohibited from singing country. Also, Charlie Pride was a big country star that was Black that wrote songs. He just didn't get a number one. But then again, it's sung in whiteface.
This is America.
Right.
Race is always a, you know how Evelyn Lozado on the Basketball Wives, Evelyn Lozado said, you are non-MFing factor. Well, race in America is always an MFing factor, okay? You can take the non off. It's an MFing factor in America.
All right. And on that note, here we go. Again, we're going to wrap up today. As always, we start off with our plugs. We had Advil Liquid Gel, Adidas, My Adidas, and then the podcasts were Her Space, H-E-R, that stands for Healing, Empowerment, and Resilience. Our wow for the week. But deeming race irrelevant in law does not make it so in life. That's Justice Ketanji Brown Jackson, right? Our what's going on was the affirmative action decision, and then we did Clarence Thomas and then Ketanji Brown Jackson's pink. Right. Question of the week. What breaks and never falls, and what falls and never breaks? Our little known Black history fact was Michael Langley. And our all hell no went to Craig Kelly, and we gave it up to Tracy Chapman for having a number one country song. First person. And as always,
thank you everybody for taking time out of your busy schedules to hang out with us. And as always, in parting, we wish you love, peace, and soul.
And so y'all have a great week, and we'll see you soon.